technology has been intertwined to our society. We use it to get up in the morning, we use it to share information, we use it to stay awake during the day, we use it to keep track of time, be more productive, made transport a whole lot easier, makes life more enjoyable overall. So how did we get to this point? It must have taken years and years of development and accumulation of knowledge and technology to actually live the way we do now. And this is exactly the topic of this video. Today I will try and explore what the role technology has been and is in human evolution. So it really is about how did we get from this to this. So what does actually set us apart from other animals? Is it the complexity of our genetic makeup? But this doesn't seem logical because we share about 98% of our DNA with our closest living relative, the chimpanzee. Also, the use of tools is not unique to our species. Primates have been known to use sticks and branches to fish for termites and also use leaves to collect water. They also teach each other through social learning, so this is also not unique to our species. Other mammals, such as elephants, have also been known to use tools just like crows. So we share all these characteristics with other animals, so the solution to this question seems to be more complex. The divergence of the Homo species from other primates started about 4 million years ago. The last common ancestor of modern chimps and humans is believed to live on Earth between 7 and 10 million years ago. This last common ancestor was supposed to be penned prior, although there's no fossil of this species in the fossil record. The lineage diverges into the Homo lineage and the Pan lineage, making up the modern chimpanzee we know today. Some genetic evidence suggests that the Homo and Pan genus might still have interbred for some years after this. So this makes the determination of the exact moment at which the lineage split a bit more difficult. The oldest fossils of the Homo species date back to about 2.6 million years ago, which marked the start of the Paleolithic era. Homo habilis was nicknamed handyman because of the stone tools it manufactured. These hand axes found from the period, or also called Older One tools. These hand axes were probably used to chop meat and defense against threat, but they don't seem to fit a more complex hunting strategy to actually go out and hunt for animals. Homo habilis did have a bigger brain capacity than its ancestors, so this might indicate a more complex behavior. Around 1.9 million years ago, Homo erectus came to the scene. Erectus is believed to be the first to form small hunter-gatherer societies and move around in small groups and set up base camps, this kind of stuff. However, hunter-gathering is not the most sustainable way for getting food, and these groups would have to move from place to place to actually keep finding new vegetation. This might have been the reason for Homo erectus to move out of Africa. It is the first species to actually set foot out of Africa and explore more Eurasian territories. This might be due to the lack of resources, and they might have used rafts to actually get to different places. It is believed that erectus had also some controlled use of fire. The evidence for this dates back to about 1.5 million years ago. However, the evidence is a bit arbitrary, and it's actually a better bet to say that controlled use of fire was widely spread in Africa around 125,000 years ago. And this is one of the first signs of collective learning among the Homo species. The use of fire created many new opportunities, like defense against predators, but also the preparation of food and being able to eat new foods that used to be indigestible. Homo erectus also manufactured a new improved version of the hand axe. The improvement of older technology also suggests signs of collective learning. Collective learning is actually the ability of a species to retain more information in one generation than is lost in the next one. In a later period, the Neanderthals again improved upon the old technology that the erectus used. And the Neanderthals lived around 2,000 to 40,000 years ago. Neanderthals also had shorter digestive tracts, probably due to adaptation to the food, also had bigger brains, which might be related to a different, more nutritious diet, and they also developed a sense of language in a way. Speech and language has been linked to genetics, though. This gene called FOX P2 has been linked to the development of language. Primates do share this gene with us. However, in humans, it is expressed a bit differently with two different amino acids. Around 250,000 years ago, the Homo sapiens started to appear in Africa. They had bigger brains than Homo erectus. Homo sapiens soon started migrating and populating other areas too. We have to take into account this migration happened during the last glacial period. This pushed the Homo sapiens to improve their weapons and technology even more. They started domesticating animals towards 15,000 years ago, and also adopted more complex hunting strategies, while also improving upon their clothes, because of the cold weather, they had to have more protective clothing. Around 5 to 10,000 years ago, different human populations started developing agriculture. They actually did this independently from each other and took place in different places. For instance, one of the first ones was Mesopotamia, but also Egypt and Asia. Hunting and gathering was no longer the most effective way to feed the growing population. Although foraging was less work than to take care of crops, a much smaller area of land was needed to sustain a bigger population. Early humans started to settle down in villages and domesticate plants. Agriculture has played a huge role in collective learning because it allows for a much larger population in one place. This leads to the more division of labor, and some people don't have to actively engage in accumulation of resources all the time. Also, the earliest evidence for writing stems back to this period, facilitating more collective knowledge. We have now witnessed the first transition of foraging to domestication of other species into our advantage. This transition allowed early humans to extract more energy from their environment than ever before through the use of collective learning. In his work, anthropologist Leslie White discusses the emergence of culture. He states that the primary function of culture is to harvest and control energy. He believes that technology was essential in this process for a couple of reasons. Because, one, technology attempts to solve the problems of survival. Two, this involves capturing energy and divert it to human needs. Three, societies that capture more energy have an advantage over other societies. And four, these societies are therefore more advanced in an evolutionary sense. White also proposed a five-stage model for energy harvesting, with the first one being muscle, then domestication of animals, domestication of plants, natural resources, and now nuclear energy. Anthropologist Jared Lenski built upon White's work and proposed the ecological evolutionary theory that aims to explain the origin and change of culture and society. The theory borrows from both sociology and evolutionary theory. Lenski argues that social cultural systems that survive do so primarily due to technological progress. He defined technology as information about the ways in which resources in the environment may be used to satisfy human needs and desires. Different societies are able to survive thanks to their adopted strategies, which allows them to extract energy from the environment. Those strategies are determined by the technology that is possessed by those societies. Lenski further says that social-cultural change is an effect of either interaction with another culture or the result from environmental change, either due to natural causes like ice ages or man-made causes like resource depletion. So in short, the level of technology is determined by the level of energy we can extract from our environment and ultimately from the sun. The development of agriculture and permanent settlement led to a surplus in food and allowed human population to grow even further. This mounted out into the first cities and states. The growing complexity of society asked for more division of labor. Class stratification of people and hierarchies were developed to coordinate different processes in society. These early states also started trading with each other for resources and goods, creating a bigger network of humans. This allowed more people to be in contact with each other and share information and ideas, leading to a bigger population of potential innovators. Trading networks allowed the first states to grow and flourish into great civilizations like the Roman, Egyptian, and Chinese empires. During the Industrial Revolution, which took place in the 18th and 19th century, we began to harvest even more energy by using fossil fuels. For the first time, we started to move from an agrarian society to an industrial one. New inventions like the steam machine, the internal combustion engine, and electricity allowed us to harness even more of the energy in our surroundings to sustain the growing state of humanity. Nowadays, we still use a lot of fossil fuels to power all the technology in our society today. We have become very dependent on this technology, and it has become interwoven into our entire human civilization. However, it's not all for the benefit of technology or humanity per se. There are also some downsides to this. What about overpopulation of the planet due to longer lifetimes? Or global warming due to unsustainable extraction of the energies like oil, coal, and wood? The extinction of species is not an uncommon phenomenon in biology. Extinction events usually coincide with drastic changes of ecology. Humans have shaped the face of the planet drastically ever since our emergence. For instance, the Aboriginals have been known to burn down forests in Australia to actually create more grasslands for hunting. This turned the landscape of Australia into the desert it is nowadays. Our way of harvesting energy from our environment is literally changing our planet. And due to the great technological dependency, it will be harder and harder for us to actually change the way we harvest energy. So will we be able to solve the problems we face today? The same technology that's attributed to these issues could have also be our savior. Our networks of collective learning right now, like the internet and telecommunications, are more intricate than ever and should be used to promote new innovation. History shows us that collective knowledge is what got us this far, and it will play a big role also going into the future. It would be rather unfortunate if we would co-create our own downfall. Technological advancement could be able to facilitate a new strategy for harvesting energy. The mission to Mars is an interesting initiative in the prospect of a worst-case scenario, including an uninhabitable Earth. We have seen that migration and travel are in the roots of human evolution, and a colony on Mars would be the first time the Homo species would truly be separated from one another. This isolation, what kind of adaptation would it lead to? How would we adapt to the ecosystem, and how will the ecosystem adapt to us? We can only speculate at this point, but there are some interesting times ahead. So, coming back to the initial question, what does actually set us apart? In short, it is our use of technology to harvest the energy from our environment, our higher cognitive capabilities, technological advancement through collective learning, and our drive to innovate. But innovate with caution, because we can't always overlook the consequences of our actions.